associate vice head of the Mahindra Chitan, yang berbahagia Prof. Dr. Nur Akmal Ibrahim, Director Inspan UPM, distinguished speakers and all the participants. First of all, I would like to thank George Committee for thank you for your invitation. Today, I just want to share my little knowledge and a little experience in doing statistical analysis. Before I start, I would like to briefly introduce myself. My name is Hafizan, and my field of expertise in chemometrics. Okay, today I just want to share my findings based on my previous and ongoing research work. Okay, so I would like to present my title, role of chemometrics in environmental forensics. Okay, water pollution perspective. Okay. Actually, what is chemometrics? Chemometry is a applied basic statistical analysis, multivariate analysis, plus for modern chemometrics, plus artificial intelligence. Okay, earlier, the word chemometric was coined in the 1970s. Okay, early development went hand in hand with the development of scientific computings and primarily involved in multivariate statistical method for the analysis of analytical chemistry data. Actually, for chemical data interpretation. Okay, today I would like to share, okay, maybe because of limited time, okay, I discuss only for a few methods, okay, step by step, okay, and how to do the how to interpret the result, the data, okay, based on my previous research. Okay. What is environmental forensics? The application of defensible scientific method to address questions related to release histories and sources of contamination in the environment. Okay, generally involves the reconstruction of past environmental events, such as the timing, types, and amount and sources of chemical release. So, for this case study today, we will discuss how to investigate. Okay, from inside the river to the source. Okay, we try to investigate the source of pollution, okay, from non-point or point source of pollution. Water pollution occurs when water is contaminated with chemical and foreign substances and harmful to human, plants, and animals. Water pollution includes chemical contamination from waste site, chemical waste from industrial discharge, heavy metals such as mercury and lead, sewage water, food processing, fertilizer, and pesticide. Okay. From the land use, this is related to land use activities. Okay. The role of chemometrics to defend the claim of water pollution incident in the form of numerical evidence. That's why we need statistics. Okay, for as a chemist, okay, we really need statistics. Okay, but today I just to share my experience, okay, from the perspective of non-mathematician. Okay. If you want to ask about the mathematics, you can ask Prof. Akma or you can ask Dr. Mahindra Chitan. Okay, this is to measure the variation of the possible pollutant, physical chemical pollutant of which significantly occur in the water body from the suspected spatial sources. To provide a pattern recognition evidence of the contaminated water in regard to physical chemical substances from the contaminated area and the possible sources of contamination. Okay, explorative data analysis consists mainly on the technique of principal component and factor analysis. In chemistry, the raw data are normally chromatographic or spectroscopic from the lab analysis. Okay, normally in environmental science, we go to field and we collect the sample. Okay, some of the parameter we measure in situ and some of the sample we bring back to the laboratory and we do the analysis, then finally we get the data in numerical form. So next one, so we need to analyze the data. Okay, for instance, it involves with chemical communication. For example, sample may contain several hundred of compounds, and the most significant may not adherent to the untrained observer. The idea of auto-sample chromatogram highlight the differences in chromatogram of different spatial group and generate a simple visual idea as to the main relationship between these samples. Okay, pattern recognition. Okay, what is pattern recognition? Actually, when we get the data, when we draw the line graph, we can see the pattern. Okay. Okay, this is we call variation in the data. Different value of observation. Okay, sometimes we get, let's say for example, dissolved oxygen concentration in water. Okay, maybe we observe, we monitor hourly. First hour, we get the concentration 1.0. Second hour, we get 0.98. So the difference in the value when we plot the line graph, we can see the patterns. Okay. One of the first and most publicized success story in the chemistry is the pattern recognition. Many chemistry involve using data to determine pattern. For example, can infrared spectra to be used to classify compounds into ketones and esters? Is there a pattern in the spectra allowing physical information related to chemical knowledge? Okay. Okay. How to do the interpretation? We really need to clearly understand, okay, to understand the nature in water pollution. Okay, for this example, I bring a river system. Okay. Okay, we can see in the figure. Okay. Along the river. Okay. The river stem can divide to three different regions. Okay. Upper course, middle course, and lower course. Okay, surrounding area dominated at the upper course. Surrounding area usually in Malaysia dominated by forest area, small village, and also known as low pollution sources. While for the middle course, considered as an urban area, where the town center, industrial estate, domestic area, etc., is also known as the highest pollution source. Okay, and at the lower cost, usually dominated by district towns, small village, housing area, and also considered as the moderate portion, or vice versa, between middle cost and lower cost. It depends. Okay? This is related to land use activity along the river system. Okay? Okay, spatial variation of contaminated river water. When we translate to the statistics, okay, we can see that, okay, for example, if you can, okay, you see this line graph, okay, we can see three different patterns. Okay, this is based on different observation. Okay, for example, our size sample is 12, so when we plot the line graph, we can see, okay, the blue solid line, okay, refers to low pollution source, which is located at the upstream river system. Okay, while for this green solid line, okay, referred to moderate pollution source located at the middle stream, and the last one, okay, this is referred to HPS, high pollution sources, usually located at the downstream, or vice versa between these two, moderate and high variation. So it depends on land use activities. Okay, if we can see here. If you calculate the standard or the variance, this is called this because we discuss about spatial variation. Okay, so you can see, okay, variance in LPS smaller than MPS and MPS smaller than HPS. HPS usually shows higher variation in the data. Okay, so for early assumption, we can see that low pollution sources located at the upper, moderate at the middle, and high pollution source at the lower. Or between middle and lower is vice versa. Okay? Okay. Spatial classification based on the data variation, a cluster analysis. Okay? We can see cluster analysis, this is represented, it's a dendrogram. Okay, we can see here. Okay, this is dendrogram. Okay, based on the observed data, that the detection of the most polluted area can be done using cluster analysis, or usually known unsupervised pattern recognition technique, where only the independent variable were taken into consideration. So we only have X variable. Okay, then when we run the cluster analysis, okay, for example, okay, we can see this is cutting point. You can see the dashed line here, and this is the cutting point and immediate joining point A and B, considered as in one group, or similarity between A and B highly similar to each other. If we do that statistical test, or t-test or z-test, we can get the result A and B statistically no significant difference. Okay, while B and C, okay, B and C form in a different group, if we do the statistical test, B and C, okay, we can get the statistical no statistical significant difference between B and C. Okay? So based on the data, we can classify as partially if A and B, A to M refer to the sampling site, so this is called spatial classification. Okay, so for this example, we can see, okay, datagram, the cluster analysis gives 3 clusters. Okay, and cluster 1, the variation is A and B equal to each other, or similar to each other. Okay, variant E and F also equal to each other, or similar. Okay, spatial question of Langa River quality. This is from my previous published paper, okay, in 2011. Okay. Hierarchical agglomerative cluster analysis was performed on the water quality data set to evaluate spatial variation among the sampling site. Okay. The classification is based on water quality index. Okay. We can see from the map, okay, the blue color, this is considered low pollution source region, and the yellow color, okay, moderate pollution source region, and the red color, high pollution source region. Okay, based on this 7 sampling station, okay, based on the water quality index, okay, so we put in the column, in 7 different columns, then we run the analysis, we get this result, okay, which is cluster analysis gives us 3 different groups, okay, of symptom site. So meaning that SB02 and SB01, okay, have a similarity, as a similar pattern, water quality pattern, okay, between them. 07 and 06 also have similarity pattern, okay, between them. But SB01 and SB07, okay, shows different pattern, different water quality patterns. Okay, so usually we can, for the future, okay, we can represent for each cluster with one significant sampling site, rather than we consider all the along the Langat River. Okay, we don't need to consider 7, but I think it's enough to consider only 3 sampling stations. So we save our cost, we save our time. Okay, to do sampling. Okay, second case study, spatial distribution of polyaromatic hydrocarbon in aquaculture sediment. Thank you, Dr. Anandi. He's also our participant today. You can ask more about the spatial distribution of polyaromatic hydrocarbon in aquaculture sediment. She's my former PhD student from UPM. Okay, in this study, okay, Haka was employed to group the sampling site by content of polyaromatic hydrocarbon compound in aquaculture sediments. Okay, this will be published in Measuring Pollution Bulletin. Dr. Zarin also the co-author for this articles. Okay, The data metric row in the name of sampling site, while the column of polyaromatic hydrocarbon. Actually, all the data analysis were carried out using Excel, Microsoft Excel. Okay, this. Okay, the objective is to group the similar sampling site. Okay, same as before. Spatiality cluster rule was performed while similarity among individual polyaromatic hydrocarbon. Okay. Compound for source adaptation was determined by cluster column. Okay. For the dendrogram A, we can see we cluster the chemical compounds. Well, for dendrogram B, this is for site sampling cluster, okay, or spatial. Okay, this is for compound. So, different application for cluster analysis in this case study. Okay, the third one, chemometric interpretation on the occurrence of endocrine disruptor in source water from Malaysia. Okay, this is also we try to cluster the sampling site and the chemical characterization of endocrine disruptor. Okay. This is the ongoing our ongoing research, okay, from history, oil spill concentration analysis, similarity characterization, okay. This is Ajima Ismail is my PhD students, okay. Classification of spill oil in the diagnostic process of oil spill fingerprinting, okay. Cluster analysis techniques are used in analyzing the hydrocarbon spill source and the nature of its background in addition to intelligent lab analysis for classifying oil spill signatures. Okay, we do the monitoring throughout Peninsula Malaysia, okay, since 2015 until now. There are oil spill variables that have similar properties of similar looking fingerprinting are clustered together as illustrated in the dendrogram. You can see here, okay, this is hydrocarbon compound. Okay, the relative distribution of various hydrocarbon spill sources that demonstrate the same identity prove that this sample originated from the same source, the similar oil. Okay. Okay. Further, determination spatial variation of water quality parameter at discriminant analysis. Before this cluster analysis, we try to reduce the sampling point. In one sample, we can measure or determine more than one water quality parameter. So next, we try to reduce the number of parameters. If we refer to the Department of Environment Malaysia, okay, they monitor 30 water quality parameters. Okay, and for example, in Langat River Basin, okay, we have 7 sampling stations along the main river. Okay, just now, based on the cluster analysis, we can reduce the number of station from 7 to 3, which is represent 3 different regions. Okay, and the next, is it possible we try to reduce the numbers of water quality parameters? Okay, based on the 3 different group or 3 different regions along the Langat River Basin. Okay, techniques for classifying discriminant analysis is a technique for classifying a set of observations into predefined clusters. Predefined clusters refer to clusters given by cluster analysis to determine the class of an observation based on a set of variables known as predictive or input variables. Okay, in general, 30 water quality parameters usually monitored by worldwide environmental agency. The question needs to be answered. Is it all the parameters, so spatially or temporally, significant high variation along the river? Meaning that, for example, if we measure dissolved oxygen concentration, if the DO is significant, spatially significant different, so if we measure dissolved oxygen concentration at the upstream river, okay, for example, dissolved oxygen 8 mg per liter, in the middle stream, which is a moderate pollution source, 5 mg per liter, and at the downstream, we measure the DO concentration is 0.5, which is so significant different. And if we calculate the variance, so it shows very high variation. Okay, this is considered the significant parameter compared to if we measure DO at upstream 0.8, at upstream 6.5, middle stream 6.1, downstream 6.7. So we can see the, if we calculate the standard deviation of variance, it shows very small variation in the data. So this is considered statistically no significant high variation to represent the spatial grouping. Okay. So using this discriminant analysis, okay, we try to determine the most significant spatial variation among the 30 water quality parameters. Okay, so discriminant analysis, also known as a supervised pattern recognition, which is they have, it have independent variable X and dependent variable Y, okay, based on three different regions, LPS, MPS, and HPS. Okay, again, spatial variation of lineup river water quality. Okay, the area is applied on the raw data post grouping of the lineup basin into three main clusters or groups defined by cluster analysis. Okay, the area was carried out via standard discriminant analysis, forward stepwise and backward stepwise with different mode of analysis. Okay, using forward stepwise VA, for examples, okay, we determine that only 5.6, the most significant variable, which is, if you measure these seven water quality parameters from upstream to relative, it shows significant difference in the value. Okay? Output indicate that these parameters have high variation in terms of their spatial distribution from upstream to downstream. We can see and represent with this classificability of PA spatial variation in Langat River. Okay, we can see the correct classification came more than 85%. Okay? And the second one, the second case study, cumulative oil spill pattern recognition. Okay, the A is statistical validation process of the CA output. The cluster were treated as dependent variable. Results show the sample oil sources are discriminated into four significant groups: oil spill, diesel, heavy fuel oil, mixed oil, light fuels oils, MOFO, and waste fuel oil, WFO. Okay, we can see clearly, okay, three groups. Okay, the A separated to three groups. Okay, and this is the gas chromatography flame ionization detector or GCFID chromatogram profiling. So, and then this is the result of discriminant analysis. Okay, then easily, okay, we can determine the most significant chemical compounds. Okay, for next, identification the possible source of variation using principal component analysis, or identification the source of pollution. But the correct term is identification the possible source of variation. Okay, this is probably the most widespread multivariate statistical technique used in chemometrics. And because of the importance of multivariate measurement in chemistry, it is regarded by many as the technique that most significantly changed the chemist's view of data analysis. Okay, the key idea, most chemical measurements are inherently multivariate. In one sample, we can measure many water quality parameters. Okay, you can see, for example, for river water quality, we can determine the heavy metals, okay, dissolved oxygen, physical chemical water quality parameters. Okay. Identification the possible source of variation, principal component analysis. The obvious example is for spectroscopy. We can record a spectrum at 100 of wavelength on a single example. Okay, then we run the one, we will run the lab analysis, okay, based on one sample, we can get, okay, so many compounds, and we arrange in column, we consider each compound as a one parameter. Then we arrange in a column. So let's say, for example, for river water quality, we have 30 water quality parameters. When we run the principal component analysis, okay, the number of water quality parameters equal to the number of new variable called principal component. Let's say, for example, we run for 30 water quality parameters, then we can get 30 principal components. Okay. sorry. But the principal canal usually not really infected. We need to rotate, okay, using Veramec rotation. Okay, how many pieces should we rotate? It depends on the eigenvalue, okay, greater than 1. Okay, we can read from the books of canals, okay. And this is case study from Langat River, identification of the source origin in Langat River water quality. Okay, PCA was employed on the data set to compare the compositional patterns between the examined water parameter and to identify the factor that influence each of the identified region, HPS, MPS, and LPS. Okay, in this case study, we only consider strong loading, strong factor loading, okay, between 0.7 or 0.75 and above. Okay, and we also can interpret based on these three categories, moderate between 0.3 to 0.5 or weak, moderate loading between 0.5 to 0.75 and weak loading between 0.3 to 0.5. Okay, this is the factor loading. Okay, we can see, for example, for Veramec factor 1, Veramec factor 2 representing the pieces after Veramec rotation. Okay, this is VF1 just a symbol. You can put anything. Okay, okay, we can see the dissolved oxygen. This is based on principal component regression. Okay, so we can see dissolved oxygen. This is also considered strong oxygen because negative is, it shows different magnitude. Okay, dissolved oxygen negative 0.76. Okay, you can see electrical conductivity positive 0.69 dissolved solid chloride. Okay, calcium, kalium, and natrium. Okay, this is strong loading. Again, how to interpret? Okay, we can give the new name for our new variables, which is we call Veramec factor. We can give the new name as a mineral salt because the component, the strong loading component, we refer to calcium, kalium, and natrium. This is considered mineral salt. How about this dissolved solid and electrical conductivity? Okay, that's how we do the interpretation. Okay, so we need to clearly understand, okay, our research. The chemical interaction in the river system due to the weather condition. This is for example. Okay, for example, we do the monitoring, okay, during the rainy seasons. Okay, the volume of river water during the rainy season, the volume of river water, water level, river flow rate, and erosion rate will increase. Okay, surface runoff will bring all the pollutant from the surface contaminated area into the river system. Okay, here, yeah, this is surface runoff, bring all the pollutant into the river system. Eroded river bank and bottom river erosion are the main factor to change the form of chemicals. Okay, parameters such as mineral from solid as a part of the soil properties to ion form and entering into the river, this will increase the concentration of calcium, kalium, and natrium. Okay, in the ion form, kalium, natrium, okay, and calcium. Okay, right. It's a good electrical conductor. So when we measure electrical conductivity, so that's why in this case study, we see the electrical conductivity shows a strong loading. And when the mineral salt concentration increase, so electrical conductivity also increase. That's why the magnitude is positive, okay, for mineral salt positive, and for electrical conductivity also positive. However, the dissolved oxygen is negative. Okay, when electrical conductivity increase and the calcium, magnesium, okay, change from the solid form to the ion form, Okay, we can see during the rainy season, we can see the water color will change to the, we can see it's like teh tarik. Okay, so the dissolved oxygen will decrease because of the pollutant already coming into the river system, and all the chemical reaction usually will consume the dissolved oxygen in the water. Okay, identification of oil spill source of variation based on GCFID, GCFN, and PCA. Okay, PCA was required in order to reduce the complex mixture of oil data and to obtain a useful data interpretation on the most significant discriminating variables. PCA allows the complex mixture data extracted from GCFID and GCFN to be classified, and this is not usually achievable through conventional fingerprints. Okay, for example, okay, for factor loading PCA after variable oxygen, we can see variable factor 1 responsible for 37.06% of the total variant, and based on the strong factor loading of significant components, it possibly contributed mainly from illegal oil transferring from vessel within the water area of Johor and Sabah and discharge from the factory producing oil from used tire. Okay, this is for identification of oil spill sources of variation of sources of pollution. Okay. In conclusion, okay, thermometric provides speed and obtaining real-time information from data. It allows high-quality information to be extracted from less resolved data. It provides diagnostic for the integrity and probability that the information it derives is accurate. Okay, improve measurement quality, improve knowledge of existing processes, inexpensive, and it provides strong evidence that cannot be challenged in court. Thank you. I open for Q&A. Thank you. Oh. Okay. Okay, I want to share my findings. Okay. What happened? One water treatment plant located there. Okay. Semuanya consider upstream of Langat River Basin. Okay, for the past 10 years, okay, no development area there, only for small village dominated by agriculture activities, forest area, and the Semenye River considered quite clean river. Okay, the water quality fall in the class 1 and class 2. But after the development of one of the industrial estate there, okay, it start facing the, I think, about past 5 years or 6 years, okay, we're facing the point source of facing the problem of water quality, okay, water pollution, which is we suspected come from the point source of pollution, which is come from the industrial estate. And I think we already experienced, I think, to shut down, I think at that time, I don't know whether Sarita Air Selangor or Jabatan Bekalan Air, okay, but they shut, I think they have experienced shut down, I think, many times, okay, because of this this water pollution. This not, I think not, this is specifically we refer to chemical pollution, okay, from the industrial area enter the our water treatment plant, which is our treatment plant only capable to treat physical pollutant, which is from the solid suspended solid and any question? Yes.
By clustering, you reduce the number of sampling location from 7 down to 3.
Yeah.
My question is, how do you determine your cluster boundary?
Oh, okay. For river, we have no boundary. Okay, but this is based on our visual inspection. However, we should go to our site, okay? We go to fieldworks, okay? Then by visual inspection, we can see the surrounding area, okay? What happened to the land use there? Okay, then from the visual inspection, okay, from the, our field trip, we can easily to make our early assumption. Okay, then we draw the boundary. And then that's why we need to do the cluster analysis. We try to prove our early assumption using the cluster analysis. Any question? Yes. Okay, we also refer to the land use activities from the surrounding the area. Okay. Oh. Number, the cluster number is given by the software. Okay. But based on our data, okay, we should rename the cluster. Okay? Any question? Any other question? No? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Fizal, for a very interesting and informative talk. I would like to now invite Professor Dr. Norak Mon, the director of the Institute, to the stage to hand over a token of appreciation, certificate of appreciation to Dr. Fizal. So, please. Co-chairman of this George, that is Associate Professor Dr.